Morning. Hope you're doing well. I was talking, so a couple minutes late. But anyway, I wanted to, never done a live stream while loading, so this one is not going to be very long because we got lots of work to do. But I thought I would bring you guys here for part of this process to show you how the loading of the wood kiln goes. As you can see, we've already loaded. We do, depending on how you look at it, we do 3 to 4 stacks of pots. Kind of technically 4. It's just that the middle stack is comprised of 2 kind of separate stacks that are kind of smooshed together. So yesterday we loaded the back stack back there, and then just about half of this middle stack. The back and the front stacks consists of 2 2-foot by 2-foot shelves. The middle stack consists of 4 18 by 24 shelves, so 1.5 by 2 foot shelves. So it ends up being 3 foot thick and 4 foot wide. So I have to stack that a half at a time because I can't reach the back side if I do it all at once. So anyway, we're going to load the top shelf of this stack. So I got to this point yesterday and had to glaze a few more pieces. So we had to stop there to get some things glazed. And then I just thought we'd start this morning because the front half of this stack that we're going to load today is also going to be very short, because I have the biggest piece I've made for this firing, probably the tallest piece I've ever made. It's about 40 to 41 inches tall, and so that means the top shelf is going to stop like right about here, so that that piece can fit in this space above that. So so we're going to start with a smaller shelf on the bottom once we start, so that I have room to put more pieces there and still have the large, there's 3 large pieces that are going to go on the top, hopefully. I've measured as much as I can to try to plan that out. So, but anyway, I will also get on and give you guys a little tour out here of all the pieces that we have ready. So, move my tripod out of the way. All right, so here's a bunch of mugs and some planters that are all in some small jars, all glazed and ready. There's a couple, some more mugs, some large planters. These are flounder bottles that are going to be side fired. So all these are going to go in the kiln sitting on seashells laying like this. And so the glazes that are on them, or the ash, some of these are just have a black slip on them. I'll put ashes on the top side and that will melt and run down around the piece as it's being fired. I have a bit more on a rack here, stuff that's staged, as well as my cone packs. In the kiln, that's the large piece that's going on the top of this stack, or this back half of that stack. And then in here, there's just a little bit more in here, ready to be loaded. And this back table here. So we got a fair amount. Here's the large pieces that are going on the front half of the next stack, so you can see how much height that's going to take to make that work. So hello from the Eastern Shore. The Eastern Shore of where? I mean, technically, I'm on the Eastern Shore, if you look at the whole United States. All right, so we're gonna leave the camera out here. It might be a little harder to hear. I've got fans going, because it's 10 o'clock in the morning, and it's already 90 degrees out here. So, all right. Here's a question. After spending so much time with the wood firing process, do you kind of avoid that good Southern wood smoked barbecue for a while? Not at all. Not at all. I actually love the smell of the wood firing, and I love barbecue, so. Eastern Shore of Maryland, Ayatcha, okay. Good day from Australia, Angry Bear. Yeah, hot day for wood firing, you're right. Yeah, heat advisory today. Thankfully, it won't get really hot until tomorrow night. And then Saturday's supposed to be 85, mid 80s. And I've got a bunch of extra people coming so that we can get the kiln loaded and fired, or fired, sorry, loaded, fired, and have extra help so people can take breaks. All right, Lake George, New York here as well. So anyway, so I'm gonna start out. Aaron's gonna help me. Y'all have probably seen Aaron Ellis before. He's gonna help me by helping put wads on these larger pieces and then set those in place. And yeah, so if you wanna help me wad it and then maybe even grab the camera after that, all you have to do is kind of pick up on this, pull it out, and then you can turn the camera around by hitting that button. So that way she can bring you in here to see how I set pieces. I have not experimented with too many Shino glazes. I would like to try, but I have lots of things I want to try, and I always run out of time. So here's the wadding that we're using. These are already rolled up into balls. This is a mixture of sand, fire clay, alumina, and EPK. And so these are put on the bottom of every single piece that goes in here and in between the posts and the shelves so that everything will separate after it's done, because the wood ash and the salt are kind of resisted by this mixture, and so they don't stick as bad as the rest of the clay does. All right, so you can see we actually have to wet these slightly so that they'll stick, and they won't stick for too awful long, but they do stick so that I can now flip this over. I have to hover this above the shelf until I get it in place and then set it down. And try not to hit the ceiling, but also try not to knock the wads off. So just like that. That was a good successful one for on video, because they don't always go that smooth, especially with the large ones. But I had to feel with my hand to see, make sure that the wads weren't going off the back of the shelf. I can show you now underneath the piece. You can see how it squishes the wads. There's the side stoke hole. When we put wood in the side, we can put some wood in the side that goes down on the floor, but then also wood that gets rested on this little stoking shelf there. So a lot of times too, I'll try to level these. I can't really get a level on top of that. So usually just step back to see if it looks like it's sitting level on the kiln, and it looks pretty good the way it is. Good thing about the wadding too, as you can see right here, the shelf is not necessarily perfect. It's pretty close, but even with that being uneven, the wadding, you can get a pot level, even if the shelf is not perfectly level or flat. So. All right. Whew. All right, you wanna start, I need to measure, get some height measurements. I have a larger one. I think it's on that white table. The highest I can go over here is probably, depending on the belly, it's probably like 20-ish.
Okay.
But just, if there's something tall and skinny in that range. So now my plan is to try to get pieces that will fit to fill in this, fill in that negative space here, basically. The best we can up in the arch, just to take advantage of all the space, but also just to give
places, you don't want to have too many places where the flame can just like easily pass through. You kind of want it to work around all the pieces to make it fire evenly and just to give kind of atmosphere on all the pieces. So.
Sound too
loud?
No.
Maybe that tall skinny one that has the clear glaze on it?
Uh-huh. That's what I'm saying.
Yeah, I'll have to put live on that.
It's 22.
Just bring it to me. Let me see if it'll fit. Then just grab the tallest of things that are in there and,
sure.
And just set them out here and you can pick one of them out here. Should have done that before we started last year.
Oh, no worries.
Yeah, that's going to work.
Oh, good. Yeah.
So I guess we can go taller than 21, because obviously that one was. But there's probably nothing else tall and skinny, is there?
No, that's it.
Okay. Yeah, let's just get a... let's do these two large urns here. And then we gotta do the lids on them as well.
Yeah.
And then the small ones we'll probably try to mix in between everything. Do you want to go ahead and start doing on the... The things that are lidded, we also fire the lid on the piece. So then we usually glue wads on the rim of the piece, and then we just stick them on the bottom so that we can then put those in the kiln. And it's easier because if you don't glue them on the rim, it's a little harder for them to stick. So. There should be another glue bottle if you want to help with that. You don't have to do it now, so if you want to. But. there's also all these little ones in that one.
You've got the other one.
So now you can see the wads glued on there. Yeah, she's actually
good.
Working on them over there. So then I'll set the lid on like this. and it will be fired just like that, and then this will come apart after the fire.
Do you want the smaller ones now, or do you want to wait on those?
You can go ahead and go.
Okay. This large one is pretty.
So it's basically like a huge Tetris puzzle. Hello from New Jersey, from London, welcome. This guy always has the best jokes. He's a school teacher, Art. He said, what do elementary art teachers and wood firing potters have in common? They both go through a lot of Elmer's glue. I don't go through a lot, but a lot of wood-fired potters wad everything ahead of time. And I could. I'm just usually not that prepared before loading. And I actually like wadding freshly so that as I set a piece, I can actually level the piece as I set it. I kind of always really like that way of doing it. So. You're drinking your morning tea from one of my mugs. Well, thank you. I hope you enjoy it. I hope it tastes better because it's out of one of my mugs. All right. Yeah, I can put them like, I'll put them around that big one. Yeah, go ahead. Funky with a couple of my handles. Stole some ideas from Danny Messinger. I did these where I shaped them, put some design on them, and then curved them on a cushion, and then attached them. So it's kind of funky. Thank you, Ray. Would I ever use a Sager in a wood firing? Oh, there is reason to. I don't necessarily use one other than just putting pots inside of a planter to take up the space, but not necessarily to make a Sager. But there is reason to do that. I just don't have one.
I only need 5, but
Now you can see this top shelf here. There's the first pot we placed. Kind of filling in all the gaps the best we can. And then what we'll do when we finish that is I'll put more kiln wash on the floor for the second half of that stack. But right now we're going to fill in gaps like this one here, maybe some small pieces here and there, just to fill in that gap the best we can. Yep.
You need also one of these?
Probably just the one mug and a tumbler, and then maybe a couple small short pieces that will go.
I think there's one still stuck to it.
I kept on pushing it down and down, and I'm like, it's washing it.
Do you think one of these can fit in there? Maybe? I think. No, there's not enough room.
No.
Yeah.
Now, let's get some wash. The triangle and square one that I have to go to 5.5 to 6.5, the other two probably don't need one. So if I did 4.5, I can put a few of them and then put some bacon or whatever else. Actually, bacon is just one of the longer. So I don't have to have. So I might do something like this. Where I thought about doing that before, but I just had that machine. So,
just like
that.
That's no fine.
That means I have to wait until November.
What are you worried would happen?
Well, the atmosphere on the floor is really wild. It's really, you get a lot of salt, a lot of reduction. But I'm going to have the seashells on the side fire pieces, and I don't know if that intense amount of, like, is going to make them stick too much, or if it's turbulent and they fall over or something, you know. Mm-hmm. But the way the clay looks on the floor is always really amazing. It's some colors from everywhere else. Mm-hmm. So those pieces would look really cool on the floor. I just don't want to lose them.
Yeah.
So I guess you're probably right with you. Do a 4.5. So give me 5
Most of my stacks I do, this one just consists of four posts. You have one front and one back, and then one in the middle of the shelf on each side. So you can do two shelves with just four posts, because the middle of the shelf shares it here and on the back. This one is actually going to have one here, one there, one in the middle where it's shared, and then one on each side. Mainly I'm doing that because that giant pot's going to be in the middle of the stack, and I'd like to have that post in the middle of the shelf there, kind of as like bearing the weight of that giant piece that weighs like, you know, 60, 70 pounds, right on that post, kind of just as a support. So.
Yeah, some of those, like, you think they get wet or something?
It looks kind of like the rain.
I don't know if the rain dripped in or something.
Well, maybe they were just damp.
Oh, Reggie, you're going to fire a wood kiln. Awesome. All right. I grabbed shells a couple of our beach trips recently. I separated the bags because these shells are actually from the Cape Fear Point or Frying Pan Shoals in North Carolina. It's actually the southernmost tip of North Carolina. If you look on a map, the Outer Banks of North Carolina comes down and makes a point and then kind of comes back in. And where that point is, there's an island called Bald Head Island. And at the point of that island, there's a silt from the Cape Fear River has built up, and it goes out like 20 miles or so out off of that point where it's part of the graveyard of the Atlantic, where it can be as little as like knee deep out, like 20 miles out from the coast there. So it's the southernmost tip of North Carolina. It's also the northernmost subtropical climate on the east coast of North Carolina. So just a little facts, but I picked up a few shells that were specific to that place because I took my kids there for the first time back in June. So I'm going to do a pot that's specifically shells from the southernmost tip of North Carolina The other bag is shells from Baldhead Island in general. And then I have some other shells from just across the channel from there on Caswell Beach. Thank you, my brain. Had so many details going there. So anyway, what we do is we fill these shells with wadding because you still need wadding for support. But then these shells sit on the piece, the pots sit on this, and then part of the shell stays on the piece when it comes out, and you get markings from the seashells on the piece. Pretty wild. So you'll see the results of that when we unload these.
Yeah, Allison, if you want to bring in some of the ones there with the black slip, that are just flying the bottle top, the triangle one.
Not the triangle one?
Yeah, it won't fit under this.
Okay.
And then you can bring a couple of the other two that strap these. That's what's going on. There's one that has washboards on it and black slip.
Okay.
Mm-hmm. 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 Mm-hmm.
Sure, if you want some stickers over there, I can't prevent them. So that's one of the more tedious parts of the whole process is getting posts set, especially on the bottom, because we put wadding, as you can see, underneath each post, on the top of each post before the shelf. But I want to make sure all the posts are level. I do that on every step of the process, but especially on the bottom, you want to make sure there's a good solid footing for the shelf. And I'll follow this pattern all the way up. You can see there's five posts. That middle one will share part of the shelf on each side. So now we're gonna put wadding inside some of these shells and then set those, set the shells on the floor and then set the pots on top of those to do some of the side fire ones. We'll probably grab a couple more Yeah, there are a couple of those, yep. And
I'm gonna set this camera over here. Maybe. So maybe you can see as I set it. If the angle doesn't work, it looks like it's gonna work. Alright, so you can see I have a seashell filled with wadding here, another one here. So I'm basically gonna set this pot like right there like that. So then I'll have like a shell there. Shell there. I might could get by with three. Let's see. I think because they're small enough, I probably can.
Okay.
See that?
Yeah.
That
sits nice too.
Yeah. And then, so. I just need to remember these are my frying pan shoals pots that are over here.
Oop.
Whoop.
Yeah.
It's okay. It just sounds funky,
yeah,
probably because it. So this one I can maybe put over here like this. Another one because I've got that one. Hopefully it's reconnected. Probably too far away from the Wi-Fi. There we go. Alright, well, it's been 45 minutes anyway, and we're losing connection, so we're gonna stop there. But anyway, hopefully you guys enjoyed that. Got to see a little bit of the process. As I said, we'll be doing a live stream sometime tomorrow. I gotta set that schedule tonight, and then again on Saturday, and then we'll do the unloading live stream on Tuesday. So anyway, hope you guys are all doing well. Have a great day, and we'll see you tomorrow.